On behalf of the Nuclear Threat Initiative, I would like to welcome you to this joint effort and the launch of our report, The Future of IAEA Safeguards, Rebuilding the Vienna Spirit Through Russian-U.S. Expert Dialogue. Our partners at the Center for Energy and Security Studies, CENESS, are joining us today to really, I think, share with you the results of a project that we are quite proud of. And I will also say, honestly, one of the most interesting projects I've ever been a part of that has truly exceeded my expectations. Before we get to the substance of our report and of the dialogue that we have facilitated for the last couple of years, I want to first mention that we are all joined this morning in a spirit of dialogue and collaboration. To that end, what I'd like to do is encourage anybody to use the Q&A function at the bottom of your screen, if you're on a desktop or laptop, and in the box if you're on a mobile device. And please send us questions or comments at any time throughout this webinar. We have an hour together. As you hear the presentations, we look forward to your comments and questions. We will be collecting those, and we are committed to saving a significant portion of our program so that we can answer some questions and have some dialogue between the presenters. So with that, I would also like to acknowledge and turn it over to my partner in this project and our partners at NTI in many projects, Anton Klopkov of CENESS. Anton has been a really excellent collaborator, brainstorming partner, creative partner, and of course, he brings amazing substantive expertise to all of the issues that we will be discussing today. So with that, again, I want to thank everybody for joining us. Look forward to our presentations and discussions, and let me turn it over to Anton.
Thank you, Corey, for your kind remarks and for your partnership over the past 2 years on the Future of IAEA Safeguards project. And I would like to welcome everyone who has joined our webinar today for a presentation of the new CENESS NTI report, The Future of IAEA Safeguards, Rebuilding the Vienna Spirit Through Russian-U.S. Expert Dialogue. I am impressed by the high level of interest in this publication, even though the issues it discusses are mainly of technical nature. I would like especially to welcome those Russian and US experts who have taken part over the past 2 years in the project and contributed to today's report, which is a product of those efforts. Without their generous intellectual contribution, their active participation, it would not have been possible to produce the report. Now I would like to use my slides, if it's possible. Okay. Next slide, please. CENESS and NTI launched a 2-year joint project in early 2019 to build mutual understanding of current challenges, to fully implementing IAEA safeguards, and to build support for more productive cooperation and collaboration between Russia and US in this area. The United States and Russian Federation, being the two of the depositories of NPT, assume special responsibilities for ensuring continuous functioning of the treaty and for supporting effective and efficient implementation of the IAEA safeguards. In the past, even in the worst times of confrontation between the USA and the USSR, the governments of the two countries were still able to maintain their dialogue on the issues of safeguards and non-proliferation. Today's contacts between two countries at governmental level, unfortunately, are very limited. In this situation, cooperation through research organizations and think tanks as NTI and CENESS is especially important. It is with this understanding our two organizations launch a joint project. The main objective of the project were to bridge the gap between Russian and US experts' visions of the future of IAEA safeguards, to develop joint proposals by US and Russian experts for strengthening the IAEA safeguard system, to create a backup channel for Russian-US dialogue on the future of IAEA safeguards. Next slide, please. To start the project, CENESS and NTI convened a group of nuclear experts and representatives of academic community, as well as former diplomats and IAEA officials from Russia and the United States with deep experience in diplomatic and technical aspects of IAEA safeguards policy and implementation. Last night, as I was preparing for today's event, I tried to calculate the cumulative number of years our project participants have spent working on safeguard issues, but I lost track after reaching 100 years. Participants with their unique expertise brought their personal perspective and analysis to the project. The full list of project participants is available in the report for those who are interested. The group met in Russia and Austria in January and September 2019 accordingly, and then virtually instead of in-person meetings after the beginning of the COVID-19 pandemic. Next slide, please. Over a series of in-person and virtual meetings, participants discuss a number of topics related to the development, implementation, and future of IAEA safeguards, including subjects that have historically been areas of disagreement. These topics included the IAEA mandate and authorities, the evolution of safeguards implementation, including the development of the state-level concept, methodology and procedures for drawing safeguards conclusion, the use of open source and other third-party information by the IAEA, addressing weaponization-related cases, IAEA staffing, and organizational issues, reviewing of case studies of several past and present proliferation crises. Next slide. As a result of these discussions, project participants prepared four papers on the following topics. First, principles and recommendations for implementation of the IAEA safeguard system. This paper was co-authored by Grigory Berdenikov, John Carlson, Tom Countryman, and myself. The second paper, titled IAEA Safeguards, Reaching Safeguards Conclusions, it was co-authored by Mark Heaps, Vladimir Kuchinov, Laura Rockwood, and Alexander Tuzov. The third paper is IAEA Safeguard System, Implementing the State-Level Concept. It was prepared by Valery Bychkov and Jill Cooley. The last but not the least is IAEA Safeguards Preparing for the Future, and it was co-authored by Shirley Johnson, Nikolai Khlebnikov, Vladimir Kuchinov, and Thomas Shearer. And as you can see from this list, it was important for us to make sure that an equal number of experts representing each project partner are involved in preparing each document so that participants from both sides could make a comparable contribution. A few minutes later, Grigory Berdenikov and Laura Rockwood, who were involved in two of these documents as co-authors, will tell us about their papers in more details. But right now, I would like to hand over to my co-chair of the project, Corey Hinderstein, who will present our joint observations made following this two-year project. Corey, over to you.
Thank you so much, Anton. I wanted to highlight before I move on from this slide, as Anton said, the tremendous amount of expertise, knowledge, and safeguards history that was represented in our group. We do call this a US-Russia project. Some eagle-eyed viewers may note John Carlson, who is actually Australian, but he is a consultant to NTI. And for the purpose of this project, we shorthand to US-Russia. But I also wanted to note two names that you don't see here. One is Laura Kennedy, who was an active and engaged participant in our project and brought her tremendous diplomatic skill to our discussions, as well as her reflections on the diplomacy around the IAEA to all of our consultations. I also want to acknowledge Gennady Pishakin, who also is not listed here. Gennady is was a longtime partner and collaborator to many of us, who was very committed to education and next generation building capacity on nuclear export controls and safeguards. Gennady was a participant in both of our meetings in 2019, and sadly, we lost Gennady last December. And so I did want to acknowledge the active participation of both of those tremendous experts. In addition, we had the opportunity to be briefed twice during our project activity by key senior officials, Massimo Aparo, the Deputy Director General for Safeguards at the IAEA, and Deputy Foreign Minister Sergei Ryabkov of Russia. And so I did also want to acknowledge and thank them for sharing their wisdom with our group. Next slide, please. As I mentioned at the beginning, we had somewhat of, in my mind, some surprising outcomes to this project. And maybe the most surprising outcome was the collaborative product that you now have available to you today. I will say that going into this project, it was full of hope, but maybe not much confidence that we would really accomplish what we ended up accomplishing. We were starting the project in the wake of some very tense discussions on the official level between the US and Russia and other countries within the safeguard setting, and in particular at the General Conference at the IAEA. And so we really hoped that this might be one of those opportunities where a track one and a half or track two process could facilitate the discussions that seemed impossible to have at official level. And the experts that we saw on the previous slide, the co-authors of the reports and the additional contributors, they really delivered on the hope that we had and instilled in us a confidence that we could have an outcome that we're here today to talk about. What we saw from the very beginning was a commitment to candid discussion. And so often candid is a code word for a discussion that has conflict. And in this case, I would say candid is just that, sharing their personal experience, sharing their observations with decades of perspective in some cases. There were agreements and disagreements on substance, of course, never personal. And those agreements and disagreements did not fall down national lines. So often you had the diplomats with a shared perspective versus the technical experts or the people who had experienced application of safeguards in certain circumstances, like in Iraq, for example, had a shared experience that others who had not participated in those activities did. And so we really saw those lines shifting from the very beginning. And I think that gave us, Anton and I, a lot of faith that after that first meeting, we thought we really could get to some really interesting outcomes. And it was important to us to foster that through the meetings, but also to create the opportunity to get to substantive outcomes that were shared. So that's why it was important that those reports that you saw on the previous slide were not written some by Americans and some by Russians, but each report, each analytical piece was the shared perspective of people on from both of our countries. So what observations do we have? There were wide areas of consensus and agreement. It didn't start there. And like I said, it didn't break down on national lines, but we did reach much consensus and agreement. We did conclude that if we could share a common set of principles that could serve as guideposts in working together on specific implementation cases and when addressing questions related to safeguards, if we could develop and share these principles, we believe it would improve Russian-U.S. relations in Vienna. And we're going to hear Ambassador Berdenikov speak on some of this later. The participants called for a process to establish performance targets to determine the frequency and intensity of IAEA verification activity in a state. And again, we'll hear a little bit more about that. And we had heard very universal and strong support for the SLA improvement project that the IAEA is undertaking to improve and transparency around safeguards. Next slide, please. We had a number of participants that highlighted the need to better communicate issues related to safeguards, both to its member states and to the general public. This is one that I really resonated with, because we definitely have seen misunderstandings that actually don't come from substance, but come from a differing level of understanding or differing access to certain information. And the more that the IAEA can share what it's doing, with appropriate, of course, consideration for confidential information, the better it will be for their own attempts to maximize the effectiveness and efficiency of safeguards and to have the support of member states. And in order to have the support of member states, we need the support of the general public, which doesn't mean that every person on the street is going to be suddenly quoting insert 549. But I think what we're looking at is a situation where people understand the core and fundamental value that international safeguards contributes to overall international security and to, in each of our countries, to national security. Participants then recommended augmenting and expanding the safeguards implementation report. This is something that has gone up and down over the years, the level of information and detail that is in the SIR. And there was a call among our participants that more information in this case could be contributive in this time of kind of shifting approaches or evolving approaches to safeguards, which we will hear about from our participants in a moment. Consistent with those last two points, the IAEA can do a better job of explaining specifically how it uses national information and open source information. So this is information that's not necessarily collected through the traditional kind of on the ground monitoring activities at sites, but rather information that is credible that comes in through other sources, which the IAEA has every right to use, but it would be helpful to understand what process that information undergoes, how it's vetted, how it's evaluated and assessed. And finally, that significant efforts are needed to plan for future safeguards implementation. There are a number of challenges. Some of those can be predicted and some of them can't. But for those challenges that can be predicted, when we're looking at potential new nuclear technologies, when we're looking at the evolution of safeguards technology, when we're looking at resource constraints, these are things that we need to have a longer view. And personally, I would advocate in the United States that we have a longer view of supporting the IAEA's efforts on some of these future challenges. So what does that mean, that future challenge mean to those of us within this project? Next slide, please. We have decided that we will continue through 2021. We will hope to have two more meetings. We hope that they will be in person rather than remote, but we'll do our best to keep ourselves and everyone around us safe if we cannot meet in person. We do hope that we will have an additional collection of joint articles, potentially to add to what we are releasing today. And we also hope that we might be able to more actively bring in the IAEA Department of Safeguards. In the end, it doesn't do the US and Russian experts or US and Russian officials any good to come up with, you know, huge lists of great ideas that the IAEA is not prepared or not able to take up. And so what we see as key to the next round of this project will be to engage the Department of Safeguards so that we can make sure that we are serving the safeguards mission to meet that national and international security objective. And with that, I will turn it back over to Anton to introduce our first presenter.
Thank you, Coria. And it is quite easy to introduce our next speaker, but also rather difficult. It's easy because I can just say this person has more experience in nuclear non-proliferation than any living expert or diplomat in the world. But it is also difficult because it would take most of our time we have today just to list his service and diplomatic achievements record. Grigory Berdyennikov had diplomatic postings in New York, Geneva, and Vienna. In the latter two cities, he served as ambassador and permanent representative. Accordingly, he served as co-leader of the Russian delegation at the 1995 NPT Review and Extension Conference. He led the Russian delegation at the CTBT talks, Russian-U.S. arms control negotiations, and so-called P5 process. He was the Russian Sherpa at the nuclear security summits in 2010, 12, and 14. He served for more than 12 years as governor from the Russian Federation at the IAEA Board of Governors. As deputy foreign minister, he was in charge of Russian non-proliferation and arms control policies. Since his retirement in 2015, Ambassador Burdenikov has spent a great deal of time sharing his wealth of experience and expertise at think tanks and research organizations. And it is a great honor for us that he is an ambassador in residence at the Center for Energy and Security Studies here in Moscow. Ambassador Burdenikov, over to you.
Yes, well, thank you, Anton, for your kind introduction. The paper in question is entitled Principles and Recommendations for Implementation of the IAEA Safeguards System. As far as I can remember, it is the first joint Russian-American paper on the subject this century, though, of course, it is not an official document agreed by the governments, but rather it represents a consensus on the level of experts and former officials who in the past used to play a role in this area. The aim of the co-authors when they started to work on this paper, please next slide, was to see whether it was possible to make a contribution to the strengthening of the non-proliferation regime through building bridges and enhancing cooperation on the issue of safeguards. We were able to agree on the paper, but whether this could be followed by the real contribution to the strengthening of the non-proliferation regime depends on the willingness of the governments to use this paper in practice. One cannot oversee the fact that at present the dialogue between the Russian and US governments has deteriorated to an unprecedented level, and no one can say what must happen before it would be ready to make a U-turn. Please, next slide. The IAEA safeguard system serves as the NPT verification mechanism. The system is an evolving one, and now it goes through a period of transition from the facility level concept to the state level concept. As any change, it is a difficult period when one has, on the one hand, to preserve what is good and useful in the old system, and on the other, to introduce new elements that are necessary to keep the system working effectively in the new situation. At the turn of the century, the IAEA put before its member states inter alia the fact that since the number of facilities under safeguards was growing rapidly, it, faced with lack of sufficient resources, could not spread its safeguards activities evenly on all of them without losing their effectiveness. Therefore, the agency should be provided with the possibility to distinguish those activities that give more grounds for bona fide non-proliferation concerns in order to be able to focus its safeguards efforts on them. Please, next slide. This was a reasonable request that had to be met with a substantive answer acceptable to all. The answer was the development of a state-level concept where the IAEA is empowered to take into account not only what it sees at the safeguarded facilities, but much wider information from other sources to make its judgment what is really going on in a given state member. But such broadening of the scope of vision is justified only if the safeguard system remains objective, depoliticized, politically sound, understandable to the states, and based on the rights and obligations of the parties involved in accordance with their safeguards agreements. The introduction of subjective conclusions in the verification process could lead to distorting the real picture and make more harm than good to non-proliferation. Since under the SLC, the volume of information under review grows significantly, and the possibilities for its misinterpretation grow accordingly, it is most important to provide for transparency of verification and conclusion drawing processes. It is essential for the states not to regard safeguards as adversarial or an imposition. The agency and member states should work towards developing and promoting a collaborative safeguards culture, recognizing the common interest of both sides in seeing the achievement of a stable and strengthened non-proliferation regime. Based on such consideration, the co-authors agreed on a set of principles and recommendations for the implementation of the IAEA safeguard system. Let me highlight a few of them, since enumerating all will take too long. Please, next slide. The IAEA Secretariat should report to the Board of Governors on the conceptualization and development of the approach to safeguards implementation developed by the IAEA Secretariat to clarify the role of objective state factors in the planning, implementation, and evaluation of safeguards. The report should include a description of reasons that made it necessary for the Secretariat to develop modified approaches to safeguards implementation and a complete list of the objective state factors which it takes into account. The Secretariat should report to the Board on any changes to those objective state factors in the future. The SLC should be implemented pursuant to the authorities and obligations contained in safeguards agreements. It is not designed as a functional substitute for the absence of the additional protocol in a state. Secretariat and member state efforts to promote universal additional protocol adherence should be continued and strengthened with the goal of achieving universal recognition of the comprehensive safeguards agreement together with NAP, constitute the internationally recognized verification standard. Only objective state factors should be used to determine safeguards implementation. Political considerations are not appropriate. Safeguards conclusions should be based on the Secretariat's safeguards activities, including its collection, analysis, and evaluation of safeguards relevant information, and not on a political judgment about a state's presumed intentions regarding the acquisition of nuclear weapons. Conclusions should be based on objective data, including IAEA inspections. Please, next slide. In its operational work, the IAEA Secretariat should analyze any information relevant to safeguards and determine, pursuant to such analysis, whether to take further steps to investigate credible indications of undeclared activities. The Secretariat should thoroughly describe to the Board of Governors the information which served as the basis for corresponding conclusions and be prepared to defend it in an open discussion of the board. The IAEA has the responsibility to ensure that nothing it does could contribute to nuclear proliferation, consistent with the obligations of parties to the NPT. The Secretariat should seek assistance from experts supported by P5 states on specific matters that might go beyond peaceful nuclear activities in NPT non-nuclear weapon states parties. If such approaches are put into practice, it will help to develop a broad-based and sustained support for application of safeguard system on the basis of the state-level concept. The co-authors expressed the view that both Russia and the US could use the principles in their work in the IAEA, either individually or collectively. Please, next slide. In conclusion, I would like to thank our co-authors, Assistant Secretary Tom Countryman and Mr. John Carlson, for their indispensable contribution to this paper, without which it would be absolutely impossible. In my view, the collaboration among the co-authors was exemplary and based on mutual respect and willingness to achieve a result useful for the non-proliferation cause. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Ambassador. We really appreciate your comments this morning, this afternoon, and also for all of your participation in the project. As Anton said, you bring a wealth of experience and perspective that we really benefited from. So thank you. As a reminder to all of our participants, please use the Q&A function to ask questions for Ambassador Burdenikov or for Ms. Rockwood, her comments upcoming, or for Anton and myself as part of the overall project. We would be happy to answer your questions and look forward to seeing your comments. Let me now introduce Laura Rockwood. Laura has experience now in both the IAEA and the private sector, fully earning her informal nickname of the Queen of Safeguards. She's not wearing her crown today. I appreciate that she's gone Zoom casual for us by leaving her crown off, but she's fully earned it. Laura was the section head for nonproliferation and policy at the Office of Legal Affairs at the IAEA, serving in the IAEA for 28 years. During that time, she was instrumental to and the principal author of the additional protocol, really the most kind of generational change in the for that purpose. But she's done so much more. She also was involved in high-level negotiations in Iran, in Iraq, North Korea, with the IAEA, and she sat between the US and Russia in other tables in relation to the negotiations of the Trilateral Initiative and the Plutonium Management and Disposition Agreement. Laura is currently the director of the Open Nuclear Network, a new innovative non-governmental civil society entity, And she has had come to ONN after serving as executive director of the Vienna Center for Disarmament and Nonproliferation for 4 years. So with that, I will turn over to Laura Rockwood. Again, we thank you very much for your participation, and we look forward to your comments. Ms. Rockwood, thank you.
Thank you very much, Corey. And as with Ambassador Benetnikoff, I'd appreciate if you would put up my slides. Thank you. Thank you very much. First of all, good morning, good afternoon, and good evening. This seems to be the state of affairs nowadays with all of our Zoom calls, but the good news is we can engage more people in this. The ongoing evolution of agency safeguards and the introduction of the state-level concept have posed challenges for the Secretariat in reaching the safeguards conclusions, specifically in the processes for decision-making, in information management, and in the evaluation of effectiveness. A little bit of history. The agency has been implementing safeguards for some 60 years now, with a view to verifying compliance by states with their safeguards obligations. At the end of each calendar year, the agency draws a conclusion with respect to each country for which the IAEA implements safeguards. Since 1979, these conclusions have been published in an annual safeguards implementation report for consideration by the board at the following June meeting. In the beginning, the agency's safeguards activities were primarily focused on nuclear material, facilities, and other items declared by the state concerned. Likewise, the process of drawing safeguards conclusions was predominantly centered on the timely detection of the diversion of significant quantities of nuclear material from declared peaceful nuclear activities. The SIR language itself describing the safeguards conclusions reflected that approach, not even distinguishing between the type of safeguards agreements. The next slide, please. With the discovery of the undeclared nuclear weapons program in Iraq in 1991 and the anomalies revealed in the DPRK's initial declarations in 1993, the implementation of safeguards under comprehensive safeguards agreements changed dramatically, with states demanding that the agency provide additional assurances, not just of the non-diversion of declared nuclear material and facilities, but of the absence of undeclared nuclear material or activities, otherwise referred to as correctness and completeness. As the implementation of safeguards evolved, so have the safeguards conclusions and the processes by which these conclusions are drawn. In December 1993, the agency initiated Program 93+2, which resulted in a set of measures designed to improve the agency's ability under CSAs to provide the necessary assurances. This culminated in the approval by the board in May 1997 of the Model Additional Protocol. At the time of this meeting, almost 80% of the NPT non-nuclear weapon states have either signed or brought into force an AP to their respective comprehensive safeguards agreements. Naturally, the requirement that the agency provide assurances regarding correctness and completeness led to changes in the way safeguards were actually implemented, principally from a facility-based approach to one that looks at the state as a whole, integrating the new measures under the Additional Protocol with the measures under the Comprehensive Safeguards Agreements and tailoring safeguards to the state concerned. This has come to be known as the state level concept. The fundamental premise behind these changes was that as confidence increased regarding the absence of undeclared activities, the intensity of safeguards on declared materials might be lessened. Rather than dive into the details of the state level concept, I refer you to the report, which not only describes its implementation, but offers a clear example in real practical terms. These changes also brought about an evolution in the process used for the drawing of safeguards conclusions. The development implementation of safeguards now starts with an analysis at the level of the state of all potential technically feasible acquisition paths that could be used to obtain nuclear material for a nuclear explosive device. This is what we refer to as an acquisition path analysis, which also takes into account state-specific factors and all safeguards relevant information available to the agency. The internal processes to the Secretary by which this is achieved are described more fully in our paper. Starting around 2012, concerns were expressed by some member states about the implementation of the SLC, particularly with respect to the state-specific factors and information obtained from external sources, as well as a perceived lack of a clear description of the SLC and the potential for biased and politically motivated conclusions by the Secretariat. A highly charged skirmish was waged between 2012 and 2015. While the dust thankfully seems to have settled, it's useful to look at some of the lessons learned. The agency Secretariat is continuously engaged in the process of adjusting the implementation of safeguards to effectively meet the challenges of detecting and deterring noncompliance by states. As the evolution of safeguards proceeds, greater transparency concerning the Secretariat's processes could contribute to a better understanding and increased trust on the part of member states. This increased confidence could also result in the reduction of member states' interventions into the Secretariat's ongoing safeguards implementation activities and decisions. Next slide, please. In consideration of the above, we offered the following recommendations for the Secretariat's consideration. First, work in accordance with the key paragraph of GC 58 Res 14, which welcomed the attention of the Secretariat to continue to engage in open and active dialogue with states on safeguards matters and to issue periodic update reports as the agency and states gain further implementation exercise. Consider publishing an article in the IAEA bulletin describing the processes for drawing safeguards conclusions, including a description of the organogram and the responsibilities for the inspectorate members, the secretariat members. Prepare more informative material for member states about how the secretariat works with open source information, third party information, including a description of the process for corroborating such information for agency safeguards purposes. And finally, prepare informative material for member states about the performance indicators used to assess the efficiency and effectiveness of safeguards implementation, and a little bit more about quality control procedures used in drawing the safeguards conclusions. The authors of a separate paper in the next slide also offered recommendations for more effective communication about the state level concept and performance evaluation, including standardized methods for assessing states' technical capabilities and estimating time to complete the acquisition path, technical procedures for establishing performance targets concerning intensity and frequency of safeguards activities, and evaluating the effectiveness of safeguards in meeting the technical objectives. Thirdly, inform member states about the new state evaluation report template and guidance, create better understanding of analysis process and state specific factors. Finally, more detailed on the Secretariat's performance in terms of safeguards effectiveness and the performance of individual states in meeting their safeguards obligations in the safeguards implementation reports, as alluded to by Ambassador Berdenikoff earlier. There also remain other challenges in the future of IAEA safeguards, as noted in the final chapter of the report. Could I have the next slide, please? In this part of the report, the authors identified future challenges and some conclusions with respect to agency safeguards. Agency safeguards play a crucial role in enhancing the international non-proliferation regime and supporting peaceful nuclear uses. To do so, however, the agency system must remain independent, technically sound, and credible. There are growing internal and external challenges to the ability of the agency to continue to provide credible assurances that states are honoring their safeguards obligations, particularly challenging in the detection of indication of undeclared nuclear material of activities. I will take this moment to refer to a paper that was done by VCDMP on the future challenges of safeguards, which discusses many of the same issues. including internal challenges. Demands of safeguards are increasing. They have limited available financial resources. They have difficulty attracting and retraining qualified safeguard staff. In terms of external challenges, there are shortcomings in the performances and effectiveness of the state and regional safeguards authorities. Another point, small quantities protocols. At the end of 2019, still 32 states had operative SQPs that had yet to be amended. We also heard reference earlier by Corey to emerging nuclear technologies, small and medium capacity reactors. The authors talk about building in safeguards by design as a way of reducing the burden on safeguards and the burden on the operators of these facilities. And there's another aspect of emerging technologies, verification technologies. Perhaps the Russian Federation and the United States could look into a joint project investigating developments in verification technologies. And what about new initiatives? North Korea, how does the agency preserve the knowledge and the skills in the event that it's ever invited back to North Korea? And will the member states ask the Secretariat to become involved in the TPNW or the so-called Nuclear Weapons Ban Treaty? Finally, there's another element which we are having trouble projecting, but the agency has done a fabulous job of addressing, and that is safeguards in extreme external situations, COVID-19. I think the agency has done a remarkable job in engaging the member states to make sure safeguards continue to be credible. Now, to address these challenges, the agency will absolutely need the support and cooperation of its member states, especially from such countries as the United States and the Russian Federation. I believe there are areas for potential cooperation, including, as I mentioned just now, research on new tools. Unified support and the cooperation of the United States and the Russian Federation is vitally important for the agency in its safeguards implementation efforts. These two countries have much in common in the non-proliferation area, and neither is served when the IAEA is used for mutual recriminations and criticisms that often have no direct bearing on safeguards or IAEA issues. Our collective interests, not just those of the US and the Russian Federation, are best served when IAEA safeguards function effectively, efficiently, and with international public confidence. Which leads me to one final point, the value of NGO contributions to safeguards. Next slide, please. To ensure continuing effectiveness, efficiency, and credibility of safeguards, may I say, to stay ahead of the game, we, all of us, member states, industry, NGOs, and safeguards experts need to act collectively. Last slide. Cooperation through NGOs and interaction with expert communities are becoming increasingly important. This joint CENESS NTI project, which I had the honor to participate with many close friends and former colleagues, demonstrates the importance of this kind of engagement and suggests the need for continuing consultations by experts on developments in safeguards arena. Perhaps investment in a long-term program of joint research in the field of IAEA safeguards. With that, I will conclude and thank both Corey and Anton for this opportunity to talk about IAEA safeguards going forward.
Thank you, Laura, for your excellent presentation and for your contribution to the project, and I mean, for your cooperation over years. I should mention at this point that first time ever I've heard your name from Ambassador Timirbaev about 20 years ago, whom you worked with when he was a Russian permanent representative in Vienna. I'm afraid we run out of time, so we suggest to ask two questions to our speakers, then to give them the floor to respond. And the first question came from Tariq Rauf, and this question is regarding the use of national intelligence information provided to the IAEA. I quote, the agency has limited means to authenticate it and the agency is restricted from sharing this information with the Board of Governors. What are your recommendations on how to address these problems to enable improve safeguards implementation? This question was addressed to Ambassador Berdenikov, but Laura, I would appreciate if you would respond after Corey asked the second question. Corey, please, over to you.
So I'm going to take the liberty to combine two of the submitted questions together a little bit. From Anka Terhova from the permanent mission of the Netherlands to the UN, and from Mark Goodman from the US State Department. So the questions are related to transparency. When we talk about transparency, is this from the IAEA to its member states or to the public? Is the first part of the question. And then related to that, how do we balance the call for transparency, which came through loud and clear from a lot of our consultations and in our report, with the need to protect sensitive information, protect confidentiality and safeguards information? So how do we think about drawing the lines between increased transparency while respecting sensitive and confidential information? So why don't we go to the speakers in the reverse order? I know, Laura, you've just spoken, but why don't you start us off with a couple of comments on those questions, and then we'll go to Grigori, and then we'd also ask that each of you keep your remarks relatively limited, maybe 3 minutes, so that we can get to our wrap up in time for all of our participants. Thank you. Laura?
You're mute. Yes, thank you, Tariq, for that question. As you know, very little of the information that the agency possesses is information provided by national intelligence systems. And every director general for whom I have worked has said, underscored that the agency will never draw a safeguards conclusion unless it is on the basis of such information, unless it is able to corroborate that information. I would like to see greater support on the member states for the IAEA's ability to investigate indications, say, of weaponization, because I believe that's essential. The Secretariat is certainly mindful of the risks in doing so if it does not do so well. So it needs the support of the member states, and it needs to try to encourage, to the extent possible, the states sharing that information to permit the Secretariat to use that information in a protected environment, very much the way we did back in February 1993 with North Korea. So great question. Transparency, balancing transparency with confidentiality, the eternal dynamic in the Department of Safeguards vis-a-vis the member states. I think we need to see safeguards as a collective, in our collective interests. And I think the Secretariat can afford to be a bit more forthcoming. I think one of the reasons 93 plus two was such a great success, if I say so myself, was because we engaged in endless one-on-one group discussions with the member states. We learned as much from the member states, I think, as the member states learned from us. So proactively keeping the member states informed, engaging them. If they have a greater sense that that they are being trusted with this information, they will be less inclined to challenge the credibility and the integrity of the Secretariat. So I think it was in that frame of mind that there was some recommendations for a bit more transparency about processes, not so much about the detailed safeguards implementation data concerning individual countries.
Thank you. Why don't we go to Grigori for his final comments in response to these questions?
Well, thank you very much. Those are great questions. Thank you for them. I think I share what Laura just said. It's really a very big dilemma, but it is a dilemma for everyone, not only for the IAEA. It is a dilemma for member states. What information they give to the IAEA, it should really be verified information. It shouldn't be just, somebody said that. And that is why, by the way, we worked on that issue, and the outcome was, as I read it, the Secretariat should thoroughly describe to the Board of Governors the information which served as the basis, I underline, as the basis for corresponding conclusions, and be prepared to defend it in the open discussion of, at the board. In other words, if the Secretariat really uses this information, and this information is the basis for the actions by the IAEA, then it has to be prepared to be open to the Board of Governors, describe it thoroughly, maybe have collaboration from the provider of this information. And then there should be a discussion in the board on this basis. And of course, the IAEA should corroborate this information from other sources and be prepared to defend it. That's the only way. Otherwise, anything could be given to the IAEA, and it will be swamped by such information, and it will be in a deadlock. So this is the only thing. As for transparency, of course, it is another dilemma. What is best to be just kept for the knowledge of member states in the closed meetings of the board, or something that should be given to general public? But the criteria should be in each individual case, it is a special situation, and the criteria should be what is best for non-proliferation. In some cases, it is really needed to go to general public, but in some cases, it is better to be kept to member states. There is no general rule for every situation. Thank you.
Thank you very much. As we wrap up, as we reach the top of the hour, let me say thank you to all of the participants. We got additional questions that we didn't have time to answer. We will be collecting those questions and be happy to provide answers directly to participants who ask them, and potentially put them out on the social media handles. For example, we can put answers to some of the questions out through at NTIWMD on Twitter, and through some of the other channels. At this time, I would like to turn over briefly for a comment from Frederick Claude. Fred is the section head for program coordination at the Department of Safeguards at the IAEA, and he will give us a very brief perspective on the IAEA's response to receipt of the recommendations of our expert group. Let me turn it over to Fred Claude.
Good morning and good afternoon, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank Corey and Anton for offering me this opportunity deliver some remarks. As you know, we started a second lockdown in Vienna. So I just wanted to tell you that we will continue to deliver on our safeguards mission. We got a great experience from the first lockdown, so we will continue to implement safeguards both at the HQ and in the field. I have a few remarks from on behalf of Max Aparo, our DDG safeguards. First of all, I would like to congratulate and express our deep appreciation to NTI and CENESS for bringing together a fantastic team of former officials, decision makers, and experts. We jointly combine decades of the most outstanding expertise in the field of non-proliferation and safeguards. So we strongly believe it was a fantastic project, and it is a fantastic project. I think the outcome of this exercise provides stark proof that the main principles and goals of effective IAEA safeguards are fully shared and supported by two of our most important stakeholders. We also believe that maintaining open and professional dialogue between key players is crucial if the safeguard system is to continue to be effective in coming decades. I would like to refer to one event I thought was open-minded and gap-bridging. I'm talking about the Moscow Non-Proliferation Conference organized by CENESS last year. I think it's a good platform for exchanging also critical views on IAEA safeguards. This kind of track two events and initiatives provide a great opportunity for frank discussions about possible differences and concerns that may be more difficult to discuss in official channels here in Vienna in particular. So we greatly welcome the initiative, any initiative that provides a platform for direct engagement and dialogue on safeguards matter. We stand ready to contribute to such important efforts and hope to see the NTSNS joint exercises expanding to assist us here in Vienna doing the job. I would like to refer to the recent DG's initiative to further develop non-traditional partnership. We think it will also offer an enhanced framework for further collaboration between the agency and interested think tanks and NGOs. My final word is a congratulations to the team. I think it's a fantastic contribution, and we thank you for this. And again, we are open to be in touch and contribute to your work. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Fred. And let me just reiterate what we have said throughout this project. The purpose of all of our participation, all of the from the NTI and CNES teams and from all of our expert participants and collaborators, is in service of the truly important mission of the IAEA. And the extent to which we can contribute to that, I know we would all be proud. So we look forward to continuing to do that through this project and beyond. We're at the end of our time now. And so it just in closing, I know it's always the least interesting part of award ceremonies when we thank everybody who got us here, but it's extremely important because while you see a few of us on the screen today, we represent a lot of effort behind the scenes and throughout the last couple of years. And so I personally, from an NTI perspective, want to thank Alex Bednarik and Richard Johnson on my team at the Nuclear Threat Initiative. I also want to thank Greg Buccello and Tabitha Sanders, who have been supporting this webinar behind the scenes. And I especially want to thank Rachel Staley-Grant, who is from our communications team at NTI, who managed the actual process of getting this report in English and Russian in different versions with each paper individually out to all of you. All of our work is fantastic, but it doesn't do us any good if we cannot share it and build support and build that army of advocates on behalf of not just U.S.-Russian cooperation, but IAEA safeguards and their mission. So thank you to all of you at the NTI team. And I'd like to also thank all of the project participants. You saw them all in the photo in Laura's presentation. It's also, that photo is in the report, and we literally could not do it without you. It's so rare in a project that you get your first choice of everybody to participate, and this is really a case of that. We truly have the A team, and so thank you to all of the participants. And you will be hearing from us as you heard. We are hoping to work with you for another year. And finally, let me just again thank Anton Klopkov and the team at CNES, and let me turn it over to him to close out. So thank you all very much, Anton.
Thank you, Corey. First of all, I would like to thank Fred, Mr. Claude, for his kind remarks about the Moscow Non-Proliferation Conference. Again, we are open for cooperation. And thank you, Fred, for mentioning that IAEA is ready to contribute to NTI CENESS future activity. We appreciate that very much. Second, I would like to thank my team, Vladislav Chernovsky, who support the project nowadays, but also Asya Shevrova and Dmitry Konuchov, who were critically important contributors to the project last year when we just started that. I also would like to thank all Russian and US experts who participated in this project. And I also would like to mention Ambassador Botsanov, who was with us in Vienna, but who unfortunately was not able to join us during other meetings. And very special thanks goes to our presenters today. So please join me to thank Laura Rockwood and Grigory Berdenikov for their presentations. And thank you to all the participants. As I understand, we have about 150 participants. Now less than that, but at the beginning had 150. And as I think Corey mentioned, we do have some extra questions. And I think we will be pleased to find time and to respond to those questions separately. So again, thank you to all of you. Corey, thank you and your NTI team for cooperation, and looking forward for new opportunities to working together. Thank you, bye-bye.